Welcome, everyone, to this, our virtual Christmas Eve service from First Baptist Church in Simcoe. We are certainly glad that you are able to tune in to this particular service. A special thanks to the worship team and those who have worked so hard to put this all together so that we could have an enjoyable worship experience for Christmas Eve. So welcome, you're in for a real treat tonight with some beautiful music. Let's begin with prayer. Great shepherd of souls, like the sudden brilliance of angels shining in sleepy shepherds' eyes, you bring us surprising mercy in the darkness. You lead us to ponder the treasures to be found in every humble circumstance, like that of the Holy Family lodged with animals bedded in straw. You lead us to ponder your hand in all mysteries and wonders, like Mary treasuring her child's birth and considering the bright future that can unfold from such humble beginnings. We praise you, God, for the gift of your Son, for such a treasure entrusted in our hands. Give us joy to proclaim the Savior's birth, the one in whom the world shall find life and peace. Amen.
Our call to worship. We who dwelled in shadows have seen a great light. Glory from heaven embraces the earth like a mother's arms around a newborn child. Tucking the earth in folds of peace, like a baby wrapped in swaddling clothes, laying the earth in a cradle of truth, like a baby trusted to a manger. As the cry of a baby splits the air, uniting the songs of shepherds and angels, let us give thanks for the birth of a child through whose young life salvation shines.
Anyone finding it difficult to feel joy these days, or perhaps for the last 10 months? It's hard to find joy when you can't see your loved ones. It's hard to see joy from behind a masked face, and it's hard to share joy without fellowship. But I believe if we can find just one thing to be grateful for, joy is possible and it's present. Surely we can all do that. Even if you're feeling alone tonight and are having a hard time finding something to be thankful for, remember what Christmas is really about. Be thankful for the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ. He came to us to save us from our sins. He came to us so we would never be alone. We can always find joy through him, no matter how low we feel. He's there to wrap his arms around us and to pick us up when we fall. Take a moment tonight and think about the birth of our Savior and the joy that comes with that. Our first song this Christmas Eve is Joy to the World.
Sure. Luke 2, verses 1 to 7. In those days, a decree went out from Emperor Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration and was taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. All went to their own towns to be registered. Joseph also went from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to the city of David called Bethlehem, because he was descended from the house and family of David. He went to be registered with Mary, to whom he was engaged and who was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her to deliver her child. And she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in bands of cloth and laid him in a manger because there was no room for them in the inn.
The first Noel is a story of following a star, both poor like shepherds and educated like wise men, being on a journey, seeking the light. Let's be on that journey with them to find the King of Israel on that first Noel.
Sheep.
to God in the highest, the angels sing out over the plains and invite us to come and adore the newborn King. Let us sing, Angels We Have Heard on High.
Welcome to that time in the service where we take a time to share with the children and, of course, the young at heart. And I want to wish all the children that are part of our church community and our larger community in which we live a Merry Christmas. One of the most exciting times in a couple's life is when they find out that they're going to have a baby. And most couples, when they know they're going to have a baby, they like to get things ready in their house. So they paint, they create a nursery, etc. But also, one of the most important things parents have to do is choose a name for the baby. Parents will choose a name, perhaps, because it has meaning for them. And it's important that they choose the right name, because that is the name the child will have for the rest of their lives. Now, to find a name, sometimes couples will buy a book of children's names, or they'll go to a library, and these days you can go on the internet and look at baby names. That way they can choose a name which they believe has special meaning. Now, I did a little research on some names that might sound familiar to some of you, just to see what they meant. Hudson. Well, it means son of Hud, and it also means strong. Carson, son of Car. It means strong as well. Violet, well, we all know that violet is the name of a flower, and it means wholesome. Noah, it is the Hebrew word for rest. Melody, well, melody means song. Levi is the name that came from the third son of Jacob and Leah in the Old Testament, and it means joined or attached. Emma. Emma is the Germanic word meaning whole or universal. Maisie. Well, that's a Scottish or an English word meaning wholesome. Sophia. Well, I knew that one from my studies in way back in university. It's the Greek word for wisdom. Fiona. Fiona is the feminine version of a Welsh name, Fionn, which is a male version. It's from a poem originally called, I hope I say this right, Fin Gael. Alana. Alana is the English feminine of Alan. It means little rock or beautiful. Lila is an English name, but it's also a very new name in our culture, and its origin comes from poems and stories. And just in case you're wondering, the name Daryl. It's a Norman French name meaning someone from the region of Erel in France. When Mary and Joseph found that they were going to have a baby, they didn't go out and get a book to find a name or ask the relatives or neighbors about baby names. They didn't even have to choose the name of the baby at all. God chose the name of their baby for them. God sent an angel to tell Mary that what she was to name her baby. The angel said to Mary, "You will have a son, and you will call his name Jesus." The name Jesus means the Lord saves. It actually is the same name as Jason and Joshua. Jesus' name is very important because the Bible says in Acts 4:12 that there's no other name that can save us from our sins. Names are wonderful, and especially the name Jesus. Let's pray together. Dear God, thank you for sending your Son. During this season when we celebrate his birth, help us to remember their salvation in the name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen.
You.
to stay
close by me forever and love me, I pray. Luke
2, verses 8 to 16. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in the manger.
Adore. Adore is a word we understand, but we don't often use in our everyday conversations. Adore. Love, respect, can't get enough of you kind of feeling. May we truly adore the one who humbly stepped down from heaven to be here with us.
Step down from heaven.
Please join me in a time of prayer. Mighty God, rain your power on your people. In a weakened world, our hands grow weary, our hearts grow hard. But on this day, great power is born. Not where life is safe, but where life is sorry. Not where life is sterile, but where life is soiled. Not where life comes easy, but where life is fought for. A baby is born, and the baby lives. Joy to the world, let earth receive her power. Wonderful Counselor, send us your word. In a crying world, our speech fades from our lips, our ears close to understanding. But on this day, the word is born, not to endure silence, but to testify to truth, not to muffle our hearing, but to unstop our ears. Not to condemn creation, but to transform it. A baby is born, and the baby lives. Joy to the world, let earth receive her word. Everlasting Father of hope and faith, lend us now your joy. In an anxious world, our hearts tremble at the thought of tomorrow. Our eyes are cast upon the ground. But on this day, all joy is born. Not that hearts may yield to gloom, but they might prepare him room. Not that eyes may be bound to earth, but that they might see the glory of heaven. Swaddle our world in your arms, even as the child was swaddled by Joseph and Mary. A baby is born, and the baby lives. Joy to the world, all joy has come. O Prince of Peace, grant us your peace. In our wounded world, our spirits bow to sin, our souls are enslaved by sorrow, but on this day, almighty peace is born, so that our spirits may not worship other gods, but the God whose rod falls on the oppressors, so that our souls may not break beneath their burdens, but grow strong while carrying the loads of the friendless. A baby is born and a baby lives. Let heaven and nature sing. Let earth receive her peace. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now is the time in the service when we take a few moments to remember that this festive season can be difficult for many people. Most often, the memories that Christmas stirs up in us remind us of those we have loved who have meant so much to us and are now in the eternal hands of God. At the very center of our being is the awareness of the end to a valued relationship. Our hearts ache, our tears flow. We grieve because of their physical absence, but we also rejoice that we have known them to love them. We also light this blue candle together as a reminder that we do not stand alone in our grief. All around us, our brothers and sisters in Christ, who although physically cannot be with us this year, are certainly with us in prayer and solidarity. These are people who share our pain. and long to give us comfort. In trying to rebuild our lives after our loss, God has provided us with a rich and diverse community from which we can derive hope, strength, and love. Together, we will experience the grace of God that is extended to all of us in the full recognition that we are never alone. Let us now light the blue candle to remind us of the warmth and light that our fellowship brings to all of us, especially those who walk through the shadows this Christmas. Let us now light the blue candle. Please join me in prayer. Gracious, compassionate God, even as we celebrate the joyous news of your Son's birth, we recognize that not every heart is finding rejoicing easy or even possible. For some, the sting of death and loss is so recent that our hope and assurance is threatened. Embrace us this evening, O God. Hold us close. Dispel the gloomy clouds that have overshadowed us. Grant us a peace that only you can give. And thank you, O God, that we do not journey through these dark moments alone. Not only do you walk with us, but we have walked together as a community. As one of us grieves, we all grieve. When one rejoices, we all rejoice. May the light of this candle remind us that your Spirit is the true light of our souls. Amen.
Song, your broken heart
Hebrews 1:1-4. Long ago, God spoke to our ancestors in many and various ways by the prophets, but in these last days he has spoken to us by a Son, whom he appointed heir of all things, through whom he also created the world. He is the reflection of God's glory and the exact imprint of God's very being, and he sustains all things by his powerful word. When he had made purification for sins, he sat down at the right hand of the Majesty on high, having become as much superior to angels as the name he has inherited is more excellent than theirs.
I've entitled this evening's message, What's on Your Table? Here's a word that I'm sure most of you have never heard before and may never hear again. N-gastration. Sounds awful, doesn't it? Sounds like some kind of horrible disease, but actually it's something that can be quite good. N-gastration means cooking a recipe in which one animal is placed inside another. One of the most interesting examples of ingastration recently is something called a turducken. Although on February the 15th on Facebook, I saw another ingastration that looked, well, a little bit odd. It showed a picture of an alligator wrapped in bacon with a chicken stuffed in its mouth being grilled on a barbecue. Yummy, eh? A turducken is a recipe in which someone takes a deboned chicken, stuffs it into a deboned duck, and then stuffs it into a deboned turkey. I kid you not. It's actually a favorite among a lot of people, and you can buy them at butcher shops, including some here in Norfolk County. Now, there are variations on the theme. Sometimes sausage is added to the turducken, or it is stuffed, of course, with bread, and then sometimes just layers of ham. And then the whole thing is put on the table and sliced. I admit, I'd like to try one someday. But I share this interesting tidbit with you tonight because I've noticed something of late, that there's a lot of weird stuff showing up on Christmas tables. And not always wonderful things showing up either on a dinner table. I've noticed that old family favorites are being pushed aside for items that were unheard of just a few years ago. Some of this has to do, of course, with cultural influences from other parts of the world. Much of it's an attempt to bring some new interest and new traditions into our lives. It's also true that planning the Christmas feast has really become an exercise in frustration for many a host. So many people have specific dietary requirements these days that it's hard to figure out what you can even cook anymore for Christmas dinner. Some people have food allergies, serious ones actually, to things like peanuts. Some are vegetarian or vegan. Some are lactose intolerant. To compensate, we now have available to us all kinds of things like tofu turkey, or gluten-free bread and dressing, organic free-range potatoes. Well, I made that one up. Diet sugar-free pies with stevia. And then to top off your feast, you can have decaffeinated coffee with soya milk. I've also noticed that every year the nutrition police pop up in the newspapers and on television to urge us to forego the cookies and instead nibble on carrot sticks. I know they're trying to help us, but frankly, enough is enough. Christmas is, in the church calendar, a feast day. A day that was set aside for some sensible overindulgence to celebrate the coming of Christ Jesus. Historically, especially in the Middle Ages, Christmas was a day in which families set aside their rather bland, ordinary diets and went all out for one day of feasting. Families would set aside their very best preserves, their fattest goose, their dried nuts, and then cooked and prepared to welcome the Christ child. Boxing Day actually came about as a way for the richer folks in society to pass on their leftovers from Christmas to poorer folks the day after the feast. And you have to remember that in those days there was no refrigeration to keep leftovers, so the perishable food had to be used right away. I guess I have to admit that I just love to have those old-fashioned, familiar types of food on my Christmas table. That familiar plate of turkey and mashed potatoes and stuffing, and have it all slathered with gravy. Yummy. Then bring out my shortbread and my Christmas peppermint chocolate crackle ice cream from President's Choice. But please, for goodness sake, hold the fruitcake and the mincemeat pies. That's awful stuff, you know. I might have some veggies if you put some cheese sauce on them. Sure, I might eat a carrot stick on Boxing Day, but then again, maybe I will only eat the carrot stick with some leftovers from the day before. I can always dip the carrot sticks in warmed up gravy to help them go down. Most families, I suspect, carry in their collective memory expectations of what a Christmas feast should look like and also include. I still, with great fondness, have a picture of my oldest cousin, Mark Fryer, eating the huge drumstick off my grandmother's enormous turkey. And I was also amazed that my cousins, the Smiths from Collingwood, like turnips. Nasty stuff. The list may vary from family to family, but the list exists. Grandma's dressing has to be made just a certain way. And only Dad's gingerbread will do. You tamper with any of these beloved items in any way, like previously removing onions from the dressing because a certain uncle of my wife's was supposedly allergic, but he really wasn't. If you remove those things, you do so at your own peril. Now, I might eat the tofu turkey, but I will make my way home after the event saying, "What was that? What were they thinking? It's Christmas, for goodness sakes." Now, if you like these new directions in food, well, good for you. At least you won't have to fight over the drumstick, or the wishbone, excuse me. Maybe I'm just an old fuddy-duddy wanting my Christmas feast to be just so. I guess you could say, Daryl, you've got to learn to adapt. You've got to learn to make the best of it. Who knows? You might even begin to enjoy plum pudding. Not a chance. Not a chance. In spite of my inflexibility, I am well aware that at least one thing will remain the same, no matter what's on the table. Among the family and friends, and the uncle who won't eat onions is the one we seek to honor. This is Jesus' day. In fact, every day is his day. And he comes, as he always does, offering himself to us, offering us his love, his peace, his hope, his joy. Maybe what we need to focus on is overindulging in Jesus, basking in his graciousness and his merciful love. Jesus invites us to the feast of his love, calling us to continually have more with him. Now, I've noticed over the last few years that my appetite's not what it used to be. Oh, I still overindulge occasionally, but not anywhere near like I used to. My eyes are almost always now bigger than my stomach. But I wonder if my appetite for God's love has also diminished over the years. Do I still hunger and thirst for Jesus? Not just at Christmas, but every day. When I read his word, do I salivate to know more, to walk more closely with him? Am I content with the crumbs that fall off God's table, or is my plate and my cup full to overflow? I guess what I'm trying to say is that the bottom line is this. It doesn't matter whether it's turkey or tofu that we will eat tomorrow or throughout this special season. What ultimately matters is, am I indulging in Jesus? This special day, every day, because in the end, it is only he who can satisfy.
Our final hymn is one that is a staple here at First Baptist at the end of our Christmas Eve service. And although we aren't standing shoulder to shoulder to sing together this year, sing with us at home if you can. Silent Night.
Right.